Hello, I'm Richard Fieldhouse, and I've been working as a GP locum since 1995 across Surrey, Sussex and Hampshire. My GP training provided a professional, nurturing environment and a devoted practice team, allowing me to gain in-depth knowledge of its systems and processes, all of which were tailored to facilitate my transition to become a GP partner. In this talk, drawing from my locum experience, I will focus on helping you to adapt to the mindset of practices when they hire locums and adjusting your own mindset to ensure that you thrive in your chosen role as a GP locum. I will emphasise the importance of avoiding the feeling of being a victim and embracing the role of a self-employed independent service provider, taking charge of your career. Additionally, I'll explore the value of being part of a thriving and highly respected team of GP locums, steering clear of the professional isolation that can be detrimental to your career, and instead working collaboratively with other locums to enhance your skills, knowledge, and overall success. We will also discuss the need to shift away from the idea that being a GP solely revolves around continuity. I first became aware of professional isolation after starting my work as a GP locum. My GP training did not prepare me to work in under-resourced practices, which were in stark contrast to my supportive training practice. The information I needed to be inducted into each new practice's unique workflow often fell short of what I needed to perform safely and effectively. Moreover, I was uncertain about establishing my terms and conditions, booking sessions or invoicing practices. I also found out that there was no NHS pension scheme for locums, and when I needed support, there was no one to turn to. So I decided to create a nationwide community of GP locums where we could support each other and worked with 15 other locums to form the National Association of Sessional GPs. Our first task was to write a how-to manual on everything a GP locum needs to hit the ground running, which continues to be a free download from our website. We then successfully lobbied the BMA and the government to secure pension rights for GP locums. We developed Locum Deck, an advanced national online locum management platform that allows practices to easily book locums directly, send their invoices, monitor payments, electronically sign pension forms, and more. Our standardised practice information pack, which simplifies locum induction, earned us a national award. After 5 years, we had almost achieved all our goals, but addressing the professional isolation that affects many GP locums remained unresolved. So in 2002, we introduced the GP locum chambers model to help locums thrive as a local team. So let's explore the four key areas where we must adopt a new mindset as GP locums in order to thrive in our roles. Traditional GP training is primarily focused on preparing us for partnership positions, emphasising the importance of control, responsibility and establishing efficient systems for optimal patient management. However, as locums, we frequently work in a variety of practices where our control is limited, yet we still hold the same clinical responsibility for each patient. It's not uncommon for us to find ourselves in situations of enforced underperformance amidst complexity or chaos over which we have no influence. Some practices proactively arrange GP locum cover for holidays or study leave, ensuring continuity of service for their patients. While on the other hand, there are practices that are overwhelmed or under-resourced, struggling to plan ahead and possibly dealing with a GP shortage for months or even years. In some instances, a locum might be covering for a GP who has been unwell for a while or has been suspended. In such cases, you may not be aware of this background information. If you're fortunate, you'll quickly recognise the vulnerable situation and take appropriate action. But if not, you may continue working under the assumption that this is a thriving practice, oblivious to any potential risks. It's essential to remember that every GP practice is a highly complex, fast-paced, high-stakes environment that changes daily. No two practices operate in the same way. So we must never assume that managing a patient in one practice will seamlessly translate to another. We will delve deeper into the influence of behavioural economics on this issue later. In the TV series Band of Brothers, Easy Company, a parachute rifle company in the US Army, finds themselves in the midst of a chaotic battlefield. Amidst the chaos, Major Winters is informed that they seem to be surrounded. He confidently replies, "Well, we're paratroopers, Lieutenant. We're supposed to be surrounded." As GP locums, we may also frequently feel surrounded, overwhelmed and engulfed by unfamiliar systems and processes beyond our control. We encounter anxious patients who have waited a long time to see a GP. Yet it's in these struggling practices that we can make the most significant impact by providing much needed support to both the practice and the community. Patients often express their gratitude and request to see the locum as their regular GP. While it's disheartening to decline, it emphasises the positive influence we can have in challenging situations. With the support that a GP locum chambers can offer, we can also contribute to spreading best practice among our colleagues. The role of a GP locum is undeniably challenging and can sometimes be undervalued. However, it's vital to shift our collective mindset, recognising the importance of locums in healthcare and acknowledging that choosing to work as a GP locum is a valid and positive career choice. Adapting to a new mindset as a GP locum involves letting go of the employee mentality, where our pay, PAYE, national insurance payments, pension contributions and paid leave are all taken care for us. As self-employed independent service providers, we must manage these aspects ourselves, embracing our role as a small business. This shift in perspective requires us to think like business owners, taking charge of our sales, our marketing, billing and accounting. If we fail to do so, our livelihood will be at stake. Your CV is your ambassador in securing work, and for practices, it's their first impression of you. Simple mistakes can make a practice think twice about hiring you. Practice managers have shared that grammatical errors, spelling mistakes or lengthy CVs may deter them from engaging a locum. Any SGP membership offers a free CV generator to help you create a concise and clear CV, and we always recommend you ask someone to review your CV. Including your NHS email address on your CV adds credibility, as it carries a certain level of assurance and enables practice to communicate patient identifiable information with you, if necessary, and helps with setting you up on NHS systems. As a self-employed GP locum, it's essential to register with HMRC and submit an annual tax return. This process can be time-consuming and inaccuracies may lead to audits or investigations. We advise you to use a specialist medical accountant who understands NHS pensions and VAT for medical services to check out and submit your accounts. Financial advisors familiar with GPs can better assist with mortgages and long-term income protection. Any small business will have an insurance policy in place should it be unable to trade and still pay staff in the event of fire and flood. So as a locum, as a small business yourself, if you put your back out saying your next Zumba class, you need to have a policy in place so that you can get sick leave. Use specialist GP locum software. Any SGP members have full free access to Locum Deck, which has been built from the ground up by GP locums and is updated every 2 weeks and used by thousands of practices. Whatever software you use, make sure it tracks all booking information. It's all too common to turn up to a session and the practice can't find any record of the booking. And over the year, you'll generate financial data for your tax return, so having a built-in bookkeeping function is crucial. A robust set of terms and conditions can protect you from various potential issues. Good locum software must include inbuilt, customizable terms, allowing you to tailor them to your work preferences and be automatically included in all communications with the practice. With well-defined T's and C's, locums can easily avoid pitfalls such as IR35 violations, short notice cancellations, practices evading pension payments and vague session definitions. GP locums can sometimes struggle to adapt to the mindset of being a self-employed independent service provider. Just like any other hired service, be it plumbing, accountancy, legal advice, hospitality, it is you, the service provider, who sets their rate, not the practice hiring you. Any practice attempting to set rates for hired services goes against established global norms. That's why, when developing Locum Deck, we ensured that it's the GP locum who sets their rate, not the practice. Utilising a reliable locum ID system also improves efficiency, minimises errors and bolsters the resilience of your locum business. This allows you more time, energy and confidence to focus on supporting practices, their patients and excelling as the best GP you can be. While WhatsApp serves many purposes admirably, it lacks the specialised features necessary for managing intricate locum arrangements. Utilising it for such tasks leaves you vulnerable. As a GP locum, it's crucial to remember that you're a skilled professional, not merely a tradable commodity. Using WhatsApp for business interactions may inadvertently encourage commodification. Instead, entrust your professional dealings to a dedicated locum IT system rather than relying on a general consumer app like WhatsApp. This will ensure your professional integrity is maintained and you're equipped with the tools tailored to suit your specific needs. So as you set out on your journey as a GP locum, imagine yourself donning an invisible exoskeleton, partly as protection against threats to your livelihood, partly as powerful tool to help you get the most out of your career, and partly to make you aware of any traps or pitfalls that could lead to enforced underperformance. Another mindset shift for GP locums is to reject the notion of professional isolation. In 2002, NASGP developed the GP locum chambers model. In essence, any local town can accommodate multiple groups of up to 15 locums who share the same professional identity, pooling professional resources to support themselves and local practices. Once established, word of mouth attracts GPs to the chambers, with newly qualified and retired GPs more likely to remain and continue to support local practices. There are five key components that create this synergistic impact. Sharing knowledge and information about local clinical pathways, helping integrate chamber members into the local healthcare economy structures and processes. Sharing highly experienced chambers managers who handle all administrative and management tasks, allowing you as a GP locum to focus 100% on patient care. They support practice managers and build rapport with practices, ensuring chambers locums are their first choice for cover. Fostering peer support through social gatherings like summer parties and family barbecues to enable locums to become acquainted with one another, forming friendships and establishing a sense of psychological safety. Consequently, during your monthly chamber peer support meetings, you are surrounded by familiar faces, individuals you trust and will not pass judgment. Therefore, if you experience professional vulnerability, such as after receiving a complaint, you are in the company of genuine friends and colleagues who can provide valuable support. Sharing constructive feedback to practices. As an individual GP locum, it can be pretty tricky to air your concerns to a practice without sounding critical and could seriously jeopardise your chances of working there again. But your chambers will collect your feedback anonymously, along with your colleagues, and hand it on to the practice in a constructive and formative way. So that lastly, all the above activity builds a reputation for the chambers members that goes way beyond the practices you work in, creating career opportunities and solidifying the role of working as a GP locum as a positive career choice. This final section looks at the need for general practice to shift its collective mindset from being predominantly focused on continuity. Continuity is often considered the unique selling point of general practice, and we frequently use it to justify the place of GPs in the NHS, but it's not without its flaws. And this mindset can sometimes be used to, in effect, gaslight GP locums, leading to questions about getting a proper job and introducing self-doubt as just a locum. A few years ago, the King's Fund conducted an in-depth analysis of continuity of care, revealing that it's not solely about cradle-to-grave care, but also about seamless patient management. This relies more on excellent record-keeping and less on having met the patient before. The King's Fund underscored the efforts made by our profession to publish research highlighting the benefits of continuity, highlighting though that this enthusiasm may have introduced an element of confirmation bias in our investigations into this area, and so suggested exploring its downsides such as complacency, contempt, collusion and patient dependency, all of which complicate the care we can offer. All of which can make us feel bad about ourselves and our career choice at a time when we can't afford to lose more GPs. I believe we actually need to focus much more on improving continuity while also recognising the value of GP locums. For example, when seeing a patient who is under the regular care of their usual GP, we should factor in the patient's usual GP as if they were in the room with us. In cases where the patient's illness is stable or improving, GPs unfamiliar with the patient can emphasise the excellent care received to date and stress the importance of future reviews with their usual GP. If the patient's illness is progressing or management is off track, GPs unfamiliar with the patient can utilise their unique perspectives and experiences to provide a different approach without undermining the patient's relationship with their usual GP. A really quick win for any GP to build a rapid rapport with the patient, one to get the consultation off from 0 to 60 in 5 seconds, is to print off and laminate a pile of GP patient profiles. Anyone using NASGP CV generator also gets their own personalised template, which gives a very patient-friendly summary of their career as a GP, giving the patient confidence, especially after reception has told the patient that there aren't any GPs in today, just a locum. In addition to continuity, there are other ways to value the work of GPs, such as recognising the importance of diversity and perspective within the profession. These diverse perspectives can help provide more comprehensive and varied patient care. Jakob von Uxgall's concept of Unwelt illustrates how individuals perceive the world differently based on their unique experiences and senses. A tick's Unwelt is made up of a combination of vibration and the chemical gradient of sweat. That of a bat would include its use of echolocation, for dogs, Unwelt, largely of smell. For us humans, our umwelts are derived mainly from what we see. But putting the diverse perspectives of all animals together, Jacob von Uxkull says we arrive at the Ungebung, the world as it actually is, very different to how each individual perceives it. So for patients, this can mean that the diverse perspectives that different GPs each bring to a single patient's care can translate into a holistic, rounded, more complete picture. Some GPs have a deep, in-depth knowledge of one place, having worked there all their career, and this can bring a rich, invaluable insight into patients who've also been there all their life, and local health services. On the other hand, there are GPs who work across multiple regions and healthcare settings, experience a diverse range of communities and cultures. What these GPs lack in local knowledge, they gain by being able to bring a much broader perspective to their patients' care, potentially identifying unique solutions or approaches to diagnosis and treatment. Researchers even suggested that this diverse perspective approach can contribute to more accurate diagnoses, such as certain types of cancer being detected more quickly when patients see different GPs. Another way to value our work as GPs is our ability to provide access to primary care, where, had it not been for our flexibility and agility to support struggling or under-resourced practices, the patients may not have seen a GP for a long time. Working in practices like this can be highly stressful, and providing continuity in these environments can be exceptionally difficult, which is why it's so galling when, as a profession, we doggedly hold on to continuity of care as a stick by which we measure ourselves against, whereas in reality it's only largely possible in thriving, well-resourced practices. Some GPs derive immense satisfaction from implementing a holistic approach to patient care, going beyond treating a particular ailment or set of symptoms, and instead really homing in on the patient's overall well-being, including their physical, emotional, mental, social, and even spiritual health. Whilst other GPs derive great professional purpose from adopting a prevention and wellness approach to patient care, particularly addressing underlying causes of illness and promoting long-term health. As we consider a collective sense of purpose, our profession, I propose one that is inclusive, modern and evidence-based, capitalising on our strengths and unique selling points as GPs. The Nobel Prize for Medicine has been going for over 100 years, recognising groundbreaking innovations in secondary care and tertiary care that have revolutionised modern healthcare. However, innovations directly related to primary care may not have received the same level of recognition, or has it? In recent decades, the field of behavioural economics has experienced remarkable growth, with prominent researchers like Daniel Kahneman and Richard Thaler receiving Nobel Prizes for their work. Their research, along with others, has provided valuable insights into human behaviour, revealing common errors, biases and assumptions that influence our decisions in real-world settings. By understanding the irrational and subconscious aspects of human behaviour, we can enhance our ability to deliver patient-centred care tailored to individual needs and preferences. Over 100 of these errors and heuristics have been identified, with many readily applicable and adaptable to general practice. For instance, Ellen Langer's experiment in a busy library involved her cutting in front of a long queue, asking to go ahead because she had a pile of notes. Surprisingly, this seemingly irrelevant justification significantly improved her chances of being allowed to cut in line. As GPs, how often do patients request diazepam because they're flying off somewhere, or do we recommend a treatment because it'll make them feel better? What impact does this heuristic have on us as clinicians, and how can we address it? The sunk cost fallacy is a cognitive bias affecting our decision-making process. It occurs when we invest significant time, money, or emotion into something and become reluctant to change our minds, even when faced with compelling evidence suggesting we are making the wrong choice. Interestingly, research shows that the more postgraduate qualifications we have, the more susceptible we are to this fallacy. As medical professionals, we may also fall into this trap when pursuing a therapeutic pathway, making referrals and investigations along a line of inquiry, continuing to do so despite a build-up of evidence against, but continue to pursue the diagnosis because of all the effort we've already made. To avoid the sunk cost fallacy, we need to make decisions based on the current situation rather than past efforts. The King's Fund should take note of story bias, which suggests that the more we know of a person's history, the more we adhere to that history. This complacency may be inherent within continuity of the relationship, so perhaps we should proactively place guards against this, such as not seeing the same patient more than a certain number of times in succession. Our brains are wired to seek patterns and connections to make sense of the world around us. However, this can lead to premature conclusions or biases, even if there's only a faint hint of a pattern emerging. Confirmation bias is similar, but where we take a more active role in determining an outcome that we subconsciously or not so subconsciously desire. To counteract common cognitive biases like confirmation bias and the sunk cost fallacy, we may benefit from considering the overconfidence effect. Research has shown that when left to our own devices, as GPs often are, we are more likely to be overly confident in our decision making. One solution to this issue in general practice is to adopt a more team-based approach to diagnosis and management. This may involve selecting certain patients or diagnoses for case discussion, or even considering a shared care model where patients see more than one GP. By incorporating diverse perspectives and expertise in our decision making, we can minimise the risks associated with overconfidence and other subconscious biases. It is crucial that our profession's shared values are inclusive and accessible to all, as everyone has different personal and professional values. If we don't achieve this, GPs may consciously or subconsciously disengage from the workforce. We must establish shared values that set us up for success, not failure, for the benefit of ourselves and our patients. Thank you for watching. As someone who's devoted their career to supporting locum GPs, I've observed that those who approach each session, practice and patient with an open mind and a proactive attitude are the most satisfied in their work. By seizing every opportunity, locums can enhance their skills and experience, setting themselves up for success in various roles, such as partnerships, leadership positions, or other opportunities that complement our portfolio careers. GP trainees receive free NESGP membership, which we extend for an additional 3 months upon qualification. For all other GPs, membership is also free for the first 3 months, followed by a £12 monthly fee. Our website features thousands of articles, and you'll receive a brief weekly email news digest.